I want to do a reading of my revision of the video to which this is a response, to see beyond. That was a very rough draft. My rough drafts are always garbage. And but it can be illuminating because I have now revised that portion that I read the other night. And for those of you who are writers, this is a lesson you can learn about the importance of revision. Some writers, they have this awesome talent where all they need to do is do a first draft on the keyboard and it's remarkably good. I am not one of those writers, obviously. I need a lot of work, a lot of revision. So, now the problem is my printer is out, the ink cartridge has run dry, so I can't print out my story to read to you. So I'm going to do it. This is an experiment, and this may not work. I'm going to minimize YouTube and then read directly from the screen. This means that I won't be able to see the little clock that's telling me that I have now been talking for 1 minute and 45 seconds. So I will probably run, you know, out of time and keep reading when YouTube stops their 10-minute recording cycle. But I think the revision as it now stands is a vast improvement over what I read the other night. So let's see if you agree. Okay, I'm going to minimize this. Hopefully my webcam is still recording. And I've got a little clock on my desktop, so I'll try to... Alright, this is To See Beyond, Part 2, Revised. An elderly gentleman sat in his dusky room by a small window through which he gazed at the silent surrounding woodland and the arched peaks of the White Mountain. A sliver of gentle moon hanged in the moody sky, and the fellow watched the clouds that congregated and swarmed above the trees that bent to gathering tempest. The old man reached for his teacup and sipped its steaming liquid, a tea composed of the seeds of poppy that had been cultivated by a resident warlock. And he sighed as the brew did its work and soothed his aching throat. Setting down the cup, he took up his violin and positioned it. And then he began to hum a quiet tune, weaving music into the song of surging storm. The stars that were bold enough to pierce through heaven's gathered darkness shimmered their little light on the gentleman's watery eyes, as his lips parted and he began to sing an odd and ancient chant in his high, cracked voice, accompanying himself on the violin. It rose, his enchanted noise, toward Mount Celta, stirring its denizens, they who raised their snouts in compliment. But then there was another sound, blending its sinister force with the old man's music and tainting it. This other vibration issued from a flute, black and lean and polished, that was pressed to the lips of an inhuman mouth. Simon Gregory Williams stepped out from woodland coverage with Sebastian at his side, playing his diabolic melody as he observed the candlelit silhouette of Jean-Eric Le Soul at the window of his room above the old curiosity shop. He stayed there as the rain began to fall, paying no heed to Sebastian's shivering, and he stared at the old man in his shadowed room until the ancient satyr face turned away from the window. He stopped his performance and playfully hugged Sebastian's neck with an arm, then walked with him to the building. "The proprietor of this place is in Europe, but you will meet him anon. We've found a nice room for you upstairs. During our days of travel, I've had some of your personal effects transported, so you won't feel totally adrift in an alien place. This way, Grim. Watch your step." They climbed the carpeted stairway that led to an upper region, and Sebastian realized that the building was much larger than he had initially supposed. He breathed heavily as they climbed, and the air taken in was unnatural, containing a surfeit of sweetness that was not pleasant. The scented air reminded him of the smell he had detected when the beast was very close to him, an odor the nature of which he could not fathom. Was it animal? Was it of the woods through which he had been guided by the beast, the rocks over which he had stumbled? He followed Simon down a dusky hallway and into the room, the door to which was open. Sebastian stepped into the room and gasped. There were the two sturdy bookcases that he had inherited from his grandmother and all of his books. There was his favorite chair and lamp, and there, the antique escritoire, looking uncannily at home in this unfamiliar room. Sebastian wanted to rush to it and investigate its secret panel, but he felt certain that neither of the spectacles would be there. He felt Simon's arm around his waist, and lips brushed the back of his neck. "This will be your home for a little while. Pretend that you actually accomplished your suicidal folly, and this is the new realm to which your soul has flown. Pretend that you are among friends, or friendly fiends. You have a gift, Grim. It is there on the pages of your one book, and it shews more than imagination. Your psyche has found a link with lonesome places. Yes, you are and will always be an outsider, but to be an outsider here is an interesting occupation, and we will keep you occupied, I promise." The large mouth kissed his neck gently, yet something in the feel of it filled Sebastian with horror. He shuddered for some little while until he realized that he stood alone. He listened to the rain and to the distant humming of a soft human sound that came from someplace near. Resisting once more the urge to investigate Van Prim's desk, Sebastian turned to the door, which had not been closed, and walked into the dim hallway. He followed the sound two doors down and knocked. The melody swiftly died, and a high voice rasped, "Entrez!" Sebastian pushed open the door and entered the room, gazing at the back of a man who sat upon a stool and looked out a window into night. One slim taper burned on a desk near to where the fellow sat, and the old man motioned with a hand to the chair at that